This is the production intent Hill Digital Cockpit System, now running on target hardware and being connected to all of the peripheral devices. Eric, why don't you give us a quick run through what we've got developed here?
Absolutely, let's go for it. Let's start right in the top here of the screen. We have very clear, bold airspeed indicator on both a needle and the digital printout. Right in the center, we have the attitude indicator with a big artificial horizon filling the whole screen, very clear pitch ladder, roll indicator, side slip indicator. At the bottom, the horizontal situation indicator with the compass, as well as traffic scope that shows any traffic threats that you can change the scale of. You also have a wind bug on the compass that shows your wind direction and speed. Off to the left, we have our barometric altimeter. Now, this is a little bit different because we are, instead of having your more traditional altimeter with multiple hands showing your thousands, etc., we have a single hand and then a digital printout in the center. As the needle swings around, the labels will dynamically update so that you have always the whatever scale that you're at showing whenever the needle is pointed at that position. So right now we see 1,000 here, but as this moves, if it does a couple laps around, you'd see 2,000, 3,000, etc.
Yeah, so the whole clock face represents 1,000 feet,
yes.
And you're just sweeping through the next 1,000 feet as you climb or descend.
That's
so
right.
It's really clear to see where you are, and it's really easy to read.
So as opposed to having to interpret various hands like a clock, you have a single needle you need to pay attention to.
Fantastic. And for customers that are opting for the radar altimeter, where will that information be displayed?
So the radar altimeter will be printed as just a digital printout underneath the main gauge there.
Great, I love it.
Off to the left, we have the vertical speed indicator. So this is, again, a dial and then the digital printout in the center. And this will change colors based off of your flight state. So if you're really low airspeed and descending quickly, then it will warn you in various other stages if you're climbing too quickly. Down to the bottom here, we have our autopilot mode selector buttons, so we can change different modes of the autopilot with those. Moving down to the radio bar, we have our transponder settings here, your squawk code, ident button, and then two large comm boxes, COM1, COM2. Both of those have your active and standby frequencies. Now I can slide over or drag over any of these boxes, and I can change, in this case, the volume setting for my comm radio, for my COM1. Or I can tap into it and it'll open a comm edit mode. Again, it shows a smaller volume slider here on the left. I've got my active and standby with a swap button, and then I've got list. So this is currently showing my nearest, but I can change this to be favorites or recents, that sort of thing. So I can select one of these, it puts it into standby, swap it in there, and then click that to enter.
And then from a flight planning and preparation point of view, the favorites list is synced with the Hill app. Is that
That's
right?
Right.
So that you can prepare your frequencies
right.
at home while you're doing your flight planning, and they'll automatically sync with the system
right.
so that they're waiting for you for your
yeah.
flight. No more scribbling on the backs of pieces of paper.
Absolutely.
Very good.
So moving up here to the engine and the TACO side of things, we have our large first limit power indicator. This shows your percentage of your power available. So 100% being max continuous power, and then the moment you go above 100%, you're into a time-limited range. And so when you go above 100%, it will show you that you are, if I just exercise this a little bit here, I'll move it above 100%. You can see it turns amber, and I see this sort of progress bar, this circular progress bar that's disappearing, showing my time remaining. If I increase the power a little bit more, it goes a different color. This is the 30-second range.
Okay, so you're always aware of how much time you've got to be within the aircraft's duty cycle and POH limitations, and that happens dynamically whenever you do it.
That's right.
Great.
And then you have fuel on the bottom here of this gauge, so just shows you your percentage of fuel, and this, as we've shown before in previous version, you can toggle this between different units, whether you want it as a volume or a mass or percentage. You can just tap to change those units or just configure it in the settings on the IPI.
And then at the top of the bar, we also get our range and our endurance calculated dynamically.
That's
using
right.
your current ground speed and your current fuel consumption, so that you always know what your fuel remaining amounts to in terms of operational flight parameters.
Yeah, it just extrapolates based off of your current setting how much further you can go with that. And then the TACO off to the right here. So this is a combined engine and rotor TACO. So you have two needles, and then the rotor speed RPM percentage is displayed in the center as the digital printout, and then the engine RPM is displayed over here. Now, if I wiggle these with my controller here, I can show you the rotor speed is the one that's on the inside, the bigger needle. And if that goes out of range, then it turns colors. So if that's under, then it goes red, or above, it goes
so this,
red.
So this is currently configured so that a high rotor speed will drive the needle high, and a low rotor speed will drive the needle low.
That's right.
Okay.
And similarly with the engine speed, which is the smaller needle kind of behind the rotor needle, is shown there.
And the whole gauge is set up just to focus on the range of RPMs that are most likely to be encountered during flight. So it's just the useful range with a bit of margin either side.
That's right.
Great. It's looking great.
So up to the top right-hand side, the top right-hand corner, we have our annunciation and warning area. So just at more of a high level, anything on the top left-hand side, we have a space in the corner here for notifications and widgets. One of these widgets is stopwatch, for example, so I can set that going and I can minimize it or maximize it again. We also have things coming in for accepting flight plans that have been pushed over from the EFB app. Other notifications would be shown there. On the upper right-hand corner, anything shown in this corner aside from this, just the trip information stuff on the very top, anything that shows up there in the upper right-hand corner is going to be a very important message, warning and annunciation, something's gone wrong. So if I just enable some of these so you can see, this is an engine fire. So you have your primary sort of resolution or box to advise you on what you should do to react to whatever the state, whatever has gone wrong.
So this is the guidance straight out of the pilot operating handbook that's paraphrased so that you can just do it immediately. You don't have to look or remember anything, just do what it says on the screen.
That's right. And then if there are any fault states, whether it's an amber or a red warning, those will all show here. So if I just enable a bunch of them here, you can see multiple. And so you have a space for about 7 of them there, and it will always show your highest criticality annunciations as priority. And then it will summarize whatever is the recommended reaction to that, the recommended guidance from the POH as to what your reaction to that would be, a pilot, whether it's landing immediately or landing as soon as practical, et cetera.
Yeah, and these are in addition to the simple hardware for the annunciation panel.
That's right.
So you've still got your wire and a bulb, things that are really fault tolerant.
That's right.
On top of that.
Completely.
These are just to make the workload of the pilot lower, to make it simpler to do the right thing.
That's absolutely right. And if you don't like this sort of message there, you can always get rid of it, but you can't remove these flags, basically those annunciations of, as you can't remove these annunciator lights when they're enabled.
Yeah. And then the traffic display that we've in here, that's ADS-B traffic, isn't it?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you have your scale, which you can drag to adjust the scale, whatever. This is my current position in this demo is at Heathrow, so we see a bunch of airliners coming in a row here into landing. But it obviously show different iconography for different types of aircraft, whether it's a helicopter or if it's a large plane, a smaller plane, there's different icons we're using to help provide that extra information so that you know what sort of traffic is around you.
Fantastic. It looks great. Should we go and have a look at it in the lab and look at some of the hardware?
Sounds like a plan.
Let's go.
Here we are in the avionics lab. We've got all of these systems laid out on the bench for integration and testing. We have the cockpit display system here broken out into its individual components. Of course, your screens that you interact with as a user. Behind the scenes, we have different processors boards that we're actively developing and integrating. Starting with the primary display processor, this is the main component of the system that brings in data from all the peripheral systems, concentrates that data, and then sends it over to the secondary display processor, which renders that into the UI, which you see on the display. Now, the primary display processor is also actively checking the output of the secondary display processor to make sure that it is correct. Now, if it detects any sort of error, whether it's a just completely crashed and it's not even showing anything in the first place, or if there's information that is misleading, then it will step in and display the reversionary UI, which I showed you in the helicopter. Now, it's not just checking a simple sort of am I alive sort of situation. It's actually checking pixel by pixel the video output and checking to make sure that what is displayed on the display that the user, that the pilot sees, is accurate. And then if there's an error, then it can intercept that and put up the reversionary UI. This is all connected to, of course, the various peripherals on the aircraft, whether it's intercom, radio, transponder, ADAHARS, GPS, all these different systems. So the primary display processor is the primary interface with all of that. So these boards will all be packaged up into a single integrated display unit. You'll have your display and your primary and secondary processors on a motherboard mounted behind that. And there'll be two of those per aircraft, one for the right hand, one for the left hand, which offers a little bit of redundancy there. All right, so let me show you some of the systems we have on the bench here. I'll show you demo some of their functions. Starting with the enunciator panel, this is the one that's above the primary flight display, just a very simple redundant system connected to the sensors for various enunciations, fault states. So I'm going to turn on one of these, and we should see it light up on the panel there. As you can see, we have battery temperature, so indicative of battery temperature outside of limits. So that's all hooked up here on the bench. We have our ADAHARS. So this is piping in your attitude, air data, your compass, all of that sort of thing into the digi cockpit. So if I move this, you should see the pitch and roll changing there. So that's all interfaced and it's all connected. We have our intercom that connects the headsets as we have mounted here. We have comm radio. We just have one currently mounted, but there will be two. And then the transponder. And then moving back to the GPS. And then as we go even further back, of course, we don't have the full length of however long the tail section would be, but we have the magnetometer here. For the magnetic compass, that's actually going to be a bit further back to be away from magnetic disturbances. Here we have a technical mock-up of our cyclic grip. This is right at your fingertips, easy control actions that manipulate the core functions of the digi cockpit. So just describing the functions here, we have on the left-hand side with your thumb, you have an autopilot mode selector switch. So if you press up on this, it will advance higher into the modes. So if you press once, it will turn on your stability mode, your attitude hold mode. You press again, then it'll activate your altitude mode. And then if you pull down, if you hold it down, it will disable, turn off all modes. And if you just tap it once, it'll just notch down to the next lowest mode. Right in the center, it's not really shown very well on this mock-up, but it'll be a very big button for your push-to-talk button for the radio. And then above that, you'll have a list button that will open up the list function, the comm edit function on the PFD, or a swap button. So if you want to swap your active frequency, sorry, your standby frequency into active, you press the swap button. On the right-hand side, we have the landing light switch. So in the sort of the normal centered position is off, and then if you push it up, that's on, and then all the way down is a special strobe mode where the landing lights blink for helping with deterring birds, that sort of thing. And then on the front of the grip, which isn't on this one, but I have it on here, is the trigger. So the trigger is your force trim release for the autopilot. And so you'll have this on both the cyclic and the collective grips. It will be the force trim release. When you press, it will detach. The autopilot actuators will detach, and you'll be able to move it without any of the control forces fighting against you. And then you can release it to set the new datum, or you can move it while keeping the control forces and just tap it to set a new datum.